Hello, everyone. So our next speaker is Kevin, and he's been a longtime KD contributor, and he works at KRAB right now. So he's going to tell us a little bit about Qt 3D basics. So let's have a round of applause for him.
Thank you, everyone, and welcome to that session. So just for the record, it will be very packed in information. Because that's something which is condensed from the one-day training we had yesterday, which is condensed from the 3 days training that we are about to offer on that topic. And so I have 45 minutes, so that gives you an idea of 3 days right in 45 minutes. But I will try to not rush it too much. So I'm Kevin Ottens. And so I live in Toulouse, so first, pardon my French, because there might be some awkward moments because of that. I teach at the university part-time there, because most of my time I'm working for KDAB. And one of the things I'm teaching, that's about project management and refactoring and testing techniques. I'm just mentioning that to basically advertise my session for tomorrow. If you're interested in applying testing and refactoring techniques when you have some OpenGL code, and since you're here, I would assume that you have that, you might be interested in my session tomorrow as well. But yeah, enough advertisement, and now let's start. So we see the basics of Qt 3D. I won't have the time to dig in details on everything. The first part, I will more focus on the actual architecture and how the API looks like, and then we will see a few of the features. So I will start first with the feature set and what is an entity component system, because we see that's a very central concept of what Q3D is made of. And then we will have a small example. So, I mean, printing text for an hello world in that case would be boring, so we'll show a nice textured donut for that. And then that's when I will get into more of the features you might be interested in. So we'll talk about a bit about the input system, which is in place there, because for 3D, obviously, that gets complex fairly quick, especially with different type of controllers you might have. And we'll talk a bit about the drawing. Then I will open the door to what else you can do, because we won't have the time to dig much into those. And then a few bullet points about what you can expect in the future in Q3D. So first with the feature set. Well, that's not really about 3D, which might be a donor. Well, what we mean here is that it's not really about 3D rendering. Okay, there's nothing inside of Q3D which mandate that it will do some 3D rendering, okay, from the architecture. So it's meant to be multi-purpose. It's not tied to make just 3D games or things like that. So it's really meant for having wide type of use, be it architecture and potentially games, but anything goes. Really at its core, it's a simulation engine with soft real-time constraints, and it has been meant, it's meant to be scalable. So we'll see why in a minute for that. So there's a few strategies in the architecture to actually keep it fast, and to be also very flexible and extensible. And we'll see that you can add more domains to the simulation than the ones we might have thought about while delivering the stock Q3D. So you can extend that. So there's this simulation engine. And so this simulation engine, that's really the core part of Q3D. And then you plug domains onto it, right? We graft domains onto it. And then it will run the simulation for all those domains in parallel. So that can be AI, audio, and of course, the 3D renderer itself, okay? That's just one of the domains that you might want to run. If you want to make a pure physics simulation to just crunch numbers, you could perfectly say, okay, I don't really care about the 3D renderer, so I would just use the soft real-time simulation engine and crunch my numbers with that. And so you can do anything ranging from mechanical systems, some physics simulation, and also games, because at the end of the day, there are complex simulations as well. So it's scalable because we have, a bit like Qt Quick, right? There's this front-end, back-end split, if you're aware of that. So the front-end is running on the main thread, but the idea is that we have almost nothing running there and everything running inside of the back-end. So the back-end itself is executed in secondary thread. That's where the actual simulation is. And then we have communication between front-end and back-end. So that sounds fairly similar to Qt Quick. Where that gets different is that, well, we have those soft real-time constraints, right? So unlike some of the constraints I have with Qt Quick, we have to have very high throughput of what's going through that simulation. And so instead of having just a single thread on the back-end, we have a single thread on the back-end, which basically is scheduled jobs, which are then run on thread pool, okay? So we have like several set of threads in there, and that's massively parallelized at the end of the simulation. So for the flexibility, so we have those domains that we call aspects inside of the API, and so you can create your own aspects. There's API for that, so you can extend it. But we provide a few, like most common ones, like input, rendering, okay. But if you find something which is not there, you could perfectly extend it for your needs. What we will see as well, that API-wise, that covers both C++ and QML, okay, so there's one mapping between the two, and it's meant to integrate with the rest of Qt, right? Because probably if you did some physics simulation and so on, and you want to have some visualization, very often you have this problem like, yeah, my data might come from some database, right? And so that night, in that case, you just reuse whatever facilities in Qt for pulling your data out of the database, right? And so we will see that its API is modeled around an entity component system, and that's used to, as we see, combine behavior for own objects, and that will avoid our API to have a very deep inheritance hierarchy or your own types having that. So I just mentioned entity component system, and so you might wonder what that is. So entity component system, or ECS if you are intimate with them, is an architectural pattern which happened to be very popular in games. And for the high throughput and we need performances and so on, those guys actually know what they're doing. And that's an architectural pattern which will push you toward having really aggressive composition instead of lot of inheritance. And so we'll have basically two concepts, two main concepts in this kind of systems. So first you have entities, and that's just a general purpose object. That's kind of an empty shell, right? An entity by itself doesn't do much. It starts to do something because you graft on it a set of components. And those components are data, and that data will control the actual behavior of your object in your simulation, okay? So you have one entity, several components attached to it, and that's how you get some behavior. So let's look at some example for that, so coming from games in that case, because that has the advantage of being visual. So Space Invaders, okay? If we look at something like that, and if you're coming from the traditional, okay, object-oriented designing of things, you're like, okay, I have this game, it will have a domain part, so I will want to model the domain of my game. And so you might want to say, okay, I have a fixed object, okay, stationary object, some which move, and some are playable, some are controlled by the computer, and so on, okay? So you have several several classes like that, and you might end up with this kind of hierarchy, okay? I have some maybe object type at the beginning because I want all my objects to run in my simulation, and then I have something which is renderable, and that can be either movable or stationary, and that can be the ground or something which blocks and so on. So we tend to do those kind of binaries, deep hierarchies when you come from, okay, I model my domain and I want something like that. But then we have like a very strong prerequisite in there that everything is renderable and that's it, right? But, okay, and now I want some of that stuff to emit sound. So how do I fit that in my design because now I have new constraint to satisfy? And then you might want to do that, right? To say, okay, well, I have base class, so I would just push the feature inside of my base class and I have renderable sound emitter. okay, well, not that great, but that gets worse, right? Because at one point, I might want stuff which is renderable, which emits sound, which might be controlled by AI, which has collision, which has animations, and you end up with a nice God object inside of your hierarchy, and I mean, we don't like that. I don't know about you, but I don't have a fetish on that. So we might want to do instead, say, okay, I will use multiple inheritance, right? And then, well, we don't like that much either, because we might end up with the diamond of doom, right? Especially if there's Q object in the mix, and or object class there, that's very likely something inheriting at one point from Q object. So we might want to say, okay, I will have base class, but I will then have interfaces I can add, so we can do this kind of things. That's kind of better, but that gets complicated very fast again, right? I will end up having quite a lot of different interfaces to inherit from, so you might be tempted to say, okay, I will, instead of having just interfaces, I inherit from one to the other and have a chain like that, but that means that you basically bake the different type of constraints you have in there, right? So if I'm doing something which is collidable, it's necessarily movable as well, which might not make sense, right? And so you're basically fixed with that and you cannot change it anymore once you build, so not enough flexibility in there. So hopefully I proved to you that the inheritance in case like that is definitely not something that you want, right? Because of the reasons that we've seen. So very quickly you have something which is either deep or wide or has multiple inheritance, or you fix the relationships between what your objects can do, or you tend to have this giant God object at the root of your hierarchy. With entity component systems, we can then change the behavior at runtime, as I mentioned, we just graft components on some entity, right? So I can go even further than what we had before. I could say, I want that object to be movable now, but now if I don't want it to be movable, I just remove the movable component, right? So it's not movable anymore. I can do that at runtime, right? I don't have any fixed behavior anymore. And I completely step aside from the inheritance limitations, right, this way. Of course, it comes with a cost, right? Instead of having one object which inherits from something, to be able to specify one object of my simulation, I will end up with several objects, right? I will have my entity object, and then I will have one object per component, so per piece of behavior I want to graft onto my entity. So it has an additional cost memory-wise, especially in our case, we're using Q objects. So you tend to have more objects in memory with these kind of things. And of course, the other cost, that's more about learning, right? Because we generally don't know very well this approach, so that takes a bit of time to get acquainted with it. But yeah, this way, at least for the engine, we don't bake anything. I mean, there's no assumption really in the core of the engine or anywhere, so we can change things later when we add features. We're not, we don't have our hands tied in any way. Okay, so now just a small example. So just a small example to show, okay, so a nice, I know we don't have donuts during breaks, but yeah, you might want to have one. So we'll see how we can do these kind of things with the engine, okay? So here, just commenting a bit on the code before showing it. Generally, that's a good practice to have a root entity, okay, because there are Q objects, so we'll be able to sort them along the Q object object tree. That's generally a good practice to have one entity which represents your world scene. Okay, so generally you will have this one object which will be your scene, and then all the other objects in your scene will be children of that one. And then per object of your scene, like our donut here, you will have an entity. And to be able to say, okay, it has a shape and it has some painting on it, right, some material, then you will have several components. So you will have a component to say, okay, that's a torus, and then you will have a component to say, okay, that's this kind of material that you have there. And so the code for that, once we assume these kind of constraints. Oops. That would look something like that, right? So here I'm using the QML API. So we have a root entity. And then we have our object inside of our simulation, right? So that's an entity which has components, three of them, okay? We have a mesh, okay, to say, okay, that's the geometry it will have. And then we have a material where we say, okay, we'll use several textures. It has normals, it has diffuse, it has specular map. So that's our material. And then we just point to the actual texture on the disk. And then it has a transform because we figured that it was autoresis generated along, we have the z-axis going through, so we just wanted to rotate it. So we rotate it on the x-axis, right? So we attach a transform object for that, okay? So three components attached to one entity, and then we get our donut. That's basically the deal with the engine. And of course, we need to see something, so that's why there's a bit more there, like we specify a camera, and then we specify how to control the camera, but I will get back to that later on. Just a note about the C++ API versus the QML API, because I will from time to time use the C++ words and from time to time the QML one, so just to scare you away. The QML API is a perfect mirror of the C++ one. So the C++ class names are named like anything else in Qt, so prefixed by Qt. There's just one thing that we are using namespaces, as you will see. And the QML element names, they just don't have the Q in front. That's basically it. So we have Q3D core column column Qnode, where that becomes node in QML, and Q3D core column column Qentity becomes entity in QML. Okay, so fairly easy to relate from one and the other, and if you know how to program one, you can fairly easily move to the other one. So how is our entity component system done in Q3D? In Q3D, we have a base class for that. So that's Qnode. So everything is Qnode, be it entity or component. That's because Qnode is the one which will implement the front-end, back-end communication. And we want that both for entities and for components. So that's mainly why it's there. Itself, it inherits from QObject. So you get all the nice features of QObject coming with it. And then we have the Q3D core Qentity, which inherits from Qnode. And this one is basically just a bag of components. And then we have the Q component, which inherits from Qnode as well. And that's where you get the actual data to specify what's in your simulation. On Q component itself, there's really nothing interesting. But that's on the Q component subclasses that you get the stuff. Like we've seen a transform where there's a Q component, which inherits from Q, there's a Q transform, which inherits from Q component. And there's Q mesh, which inherits from Q component, and so on and so on. Okay, so that's how you get all of that. So that's basically how it looks. Okay, we have Q object, then Q node inheriting from it, Q entity and Q component inheriting from both from Q node, and Q entity aggregating Q components. And of course, that's an entity component system. So I talk about the entities, the components, and you still need a system to run that. So the simulation, that's our system that's run by Q Aspect Engine. Okay, so that's the name of the class which gets everything in order to work. And on this engine, you can register aspects, which are all inheriting from Q Abstract Aspect. And they are the one which actually provide behavior for a family of components. Okay, as I said, something like a transform that's just pure data. We just say, okay, that we want a rotation on X of that amount of degrees. But at one point, there needs to be a piece of code which actually act on the renderer, for instance, to provide the actual behavior. So this behavior that's implementing the different aspects. And by default, we provide, so you're not forced to use them all, okay, but that's what's provided in the Q3D package. You get Q render aspect for rendering, Q input aspect for the input, and Q logic aspect if you want to have some extra logic to control the objects in your simulation. The aspects, they basically have no API on their own, okay? They just inherit from current Respect. You just register them on the aspect engine, and that's about it, okay? And I'm running a bit out of time, so I will have to run. So for input. For input, we basically have the low-level stuff, okay? That's the physical devices. So physical devices, right now, that's basically the keyboard device, mouse device, and that's about it. There's more devices in the work. And so other can be, will be added later. On its own, device doesn't do much. There's basically just signals on it to say, okay, I've seen a key press, I've seen a key release, or the mouse moved that way, okay? So simple, events. And nothing really analog, right? That's, you just get informed. With that, we also provide, so, object picker, class. Because we have the 3D scenes, right, that you might render, and you want your user, when he clicks with the mouse, for instance, to be able to say, okay, that's the object that I'm pointing at, right? So you need an object picker for that, fairly similar to what you would have with mouse area, except that it works in 3D. And so you can know if the mouse is in there, you can know if it's been clicked, pressed, released, etc. Very often in these kind of things, you cannot work just with the physical device or the object picker, okay? You might want to have a higher level view on your actual input devices and create your own logical devices, which would be, like for instance, weaving both information coming from the mouse and from the keyboard, and because I press this key while moving the mouse and I do something, right? So you need to have this, this extra layer, and that's also the one which provides the analog view on what's in there, so you, when you move the mouse, you actually have a value varying instead of having just events saying, okay, it moved by that amount of pixels. And so I don't think I will have the time to show the code. Then you can do these kind of things with logical inputs. You can create actions, and so those actions can be mapped to different events. So in that case, we're having something fairly simple where we're having so a keyboard device, to hook on my keyboard, and you won't see my hand, so you will have to trust me on that. But then we create two actions. So one which grows the cube, and that's done only if I press Q and W at the same time, so that's what we call a chord. So if I press Q and W at the same time, it grows, right? But if I press just one and I wait for too long and press the second one, then nothing happens. Okay, so you have these kind of controls. There's also sequences, which allows you to say, okay, if I press Z and X next to each other, then I start rotating animation, and in the other direction, so X and Z, then it stops. Okay, so that's the kind of features that you get, and I have only a handful of minutes, so I will, unfortunately, we'll have to skip the code for that. We also have, so the logical inputs for axes, and those axes you can create from keyboard events or from mouse events and so on, okay? So you can do something like that one. So if I press and anywhere actually, if I press anywhere and move the mouse and I get the rotation, okay, because I have a logical device layered on top of my mouse and I say that logical device has two axes which happen to be mapped on the one of the mouse, okay? And then you can put it all together, so with the object picker and with the different axes. So we have an object picker on all our boxes, and when box get the focus, it actually grows, right? I can change that focus with tab, and I can move things around. I can move as well with the keyboard, okay? And instead of having, you know, this repetition of the keyboard, I have something which is actually smooth and nice, right? So I have proper rotation and so on. So I would just stop one second on that one because it's there's a bit more stuff there. But that one. So these kind of things is done like so we have a keyboard device, and then we have a logical device, and we specify the axis of that logical device, and we have four of them. So we have the rotation on Y, positive. Oh no, that's a negative one. Negative, positive. Okay, and then translation on X, positive, negative, and that's mapped to, so we create an axis which comes from Bhutan, and we specify the Bhutan and the type of acceleration we want. And then all the event handling behind the scene is all dealt for you, okay? So for the drawing, well, that's similar picture. So for the drawing, we'll have more components, and with those components, you can actually create what we call a scene graph. And so those scene graph, that would be a bit like what we've seen with the donut, okay? We have entities with meshes, with materials, with transforms. A few words about the transforms. So you can transform one object, you can scale it, rotate it, and so on. And if you have, and that's a bit like with QWidgets or QQuickItem, okay? If I have a transform on the parent of an entity, then the transform is applied to the children as well, okay? So that accumulates along the object tree. And if I want to render, I will need to actually see my scene graph. And so for that, I need a point of view on it, and that will be done with cameras. So Qtransform, that's one of those components, and that represents a fine transformation. So you can scale, rotate, translate. You can do that with properties, which is fairly handy when you're using especially QML for bindings. You can also use helper functions to say, okay, I want to rotate around a given point in space, for instance, and that will compute the matrix for you. Or you can directly specify your own transformation matrix if you want to. Yep. Okay, so if we have something like that, so we have two entities, both with a transform component. Okay, in memory, what we have there, that would be this kind of situation. And the when I see the child entity, okay, I see its transform cumulated with the transform of its parent. For geometries, by default, we provide quite a few of them. Those ones are in a specific library that we call extras, so we have plenty of extra stuff in there, like materials and geometries. All the basic geometries are basically provided. And so to see something first, you need those geometries. But you need also materials, okay? And again, for the materials, we provide quite a few of the traditional materials. So the Phong material, Phong alpha, if you want to have some transparency. Diffuse map, if you have something textured like the chest that we have there. Diffuse specular map, if you want to have something more complex where the light is actually not uniformly reflected, and so on. And of course, to see something, if I have just geometries and materials, I see nothing because I have no light in my scene. So we also provide lights. And so we have three types of lights for the time being. So directional light, point light, and spotlight. Okay, so with that, you can start to create fairly interesting scenes. Okay, so I rushed a bit through. Much time left? 5? Okay. So I would just open the door to more. So for the geometries, that would be fairly boring if you could only use the geometries we provide. So there's actually a geometry renderer, which is a base class for all the geometries I mentioned just before. And so you can inherit from that and from C++, for instance, make your own geometry, okay? And that's fairly low-level API in that regard because you can create your own buffer as you would, almost as you would do with naked OpenGL, for instance, and specify all the vertices and how they are layouted in your buffer. And then with that, you can really start to get creative and make your own geometries. So like with that small example where we have a geometry which is generated from a function. So that function that's basically taking as input the distance between the center of my object and where my point, my current point is. And then we compute 8, so the how to position the point on the z-axis. So here I just have a constant, so I see a plane. But if I change the function for something which would be linear, I get, okay, I start to get my shape. And if that's quadratic, then I get this kind of shapes again, so which I can look at, okay? Or I could start to have something like use trigonometry and a sine, that's a cos, that one, I think. So a cosinus, and then to start to have, you know, harmonics in there. So that's two cosinuses with harmonics. And of course, I can, from the C++, say, okay, I want to change the coordinates on my point, and I can put the time inside there, for instance, and you can do something like that, okay? So here I have something which is completely animated. If you look at the QML code, you don't see any animation being requested. That's purely from updating the content of the buffer, and then the rest of the system just reacts to that, and we don't have anything else to do. For textures, you can, so I mentioned materials. Again, you can make your own materials. For those ones, that's actually more interesting to do them on the QML side than the C++ side. And so you can go with more complex materials, like instead of having just one texture, you might want, like in that example, we have three textures because we have on the same sphere, because we have the texture when you actually have the sunlight, the texture when it's actually nighttime, and then we layer on top the clouds, okay? So you're not tied with the materials we provide, okay? You can plug your own shader and create your own material to be able to composite your textures as you wish. And of course, you can, since you can plug your own shaders, you can go, for instance, to there's this shader toy website where people share a lot of different shaders to make some special effects. And that's fairly easy to pick one and just plug that into a material system and override the default shader of a given material and say, okay, that's the one I want to run. And for instance, that one is actually a plasma effect coming from shader toy that we took as is, okay? And since I mentioned that it would integrate with Qt, one of the integration points we want with Qt that's actually Qt Quick, because very often there's a need of, hey, okay, I have my 3D scene, but then on top I would like to have controls which comes from Qt Quick, so I would want my buttons, my 2D overlay on top, and that's something which is done with a special Qt Quick item which is named Scene 3D, which is provided in the Qt Quick Scene 3D module, which allows you to have like a regular item, and the children of that item then are entities, okay? And from there, well, you're in Qt 3D, and then everything around is Qt Quick, okay? So in the same file, you can seamlessly blend between the two. So here I have, that's Qt Quick Controls 2. That's Qt Quick Control 2, and what I have behind, that's a real Qt 3D scene. And so I can, since that's all QML code, I can just start to have a Qt Quick animation, and then I can bind the rotation of my, of the transform of my cube to that animation, and done, right? And of course, there's even more than that. So we have everything for layer management. If you want to have different layers inside of your scene and be able to say, I want to enable or disable that particular set of objects, then we can do that. As we've seen, you can make your own materials and your own lighting models. We manage texture MIP maps, cube maps, and there's portability baked inside of the engine. That's portability on several versions of OpenGL. So it supports OpenGL 3, 4, ES2, EF3, and basically introspect about, okay, what is actually supported, and then we'll take the right OpenGL calls depending on what your system actually supports. And one thing also which is interesting is that most of the engines, they come with some assumption on, for instance, how the rendering will be done. In the case of our rendering aspect, you have complete control over the rendering algorithm. We have something which is called a frame graph, which allows you to say, how the rendering will be done. Okay, so how many passes you want to do. So for post-processing effects, for instance, you can completely control from QML that I want to render my scene not on screen. I want to render it in a frame buffer. And then I want to blur that frame buffer. And then finally, that frame buffer ends up on screen. Okay, so you can completely control that if you want to. And that also come with instance rendering being supported, which allows you to have a great number of objects in a scene moving without much memory being consumed, because basically create only one object, and that's on the GPU that the magic happens, and it duplicates the object hundreds of times if you ask it to. So that gives something like that, for instance. So that one you could do without the instance rendering, but then you would have something very choppy because you would spend too much time updating all the position of all the asteroids. And then the renderer would spend too much time rendering each asteroid as a separate object. While here we, in fact, have only 5 asteroids created on the front end. And then we just say to the back end, okay, that one I wanted 200 times, that one as well, with different positions, which are all specified in buffer. And so we have something which is actually smooth. So plenty of room for controlling the performance of your actual system. Okay, about the future, since I'm probably running over time. For the core, we are planning on having improvements. So there's improvements, new APIs appearing, but especially efficiency and bug fixing. And even we are still tuning the thread pool strategy for parallelized, for the multi-threading in there. For the render, we'll have more opportunities for integration with the ability of using Qt Quick or the result of a Qt Painter inside of a texture, and support for all level of details, text, billboards, and so on. For the input system, so we plan to have even higher level construct than what I have seen, so that you could have a value which represents an absolute position in space or velocity, and have that vary depending on what's happening in one of your logical device. And we plan to add more device support like 3D mouse systems, game controllers, and so on. We're also planning on new aspects for collision detection animations, with the idea of having at least keyframe and skeletal animations, and potentially to morph, like morphing meshes, for instance. And we want that because right now, I mean, what I've seen, most of the animations are done using Qt Quick 2. And we know that those ones actually run on the main thread. So we'd like to have a specific aspect for animation so that even that can be offloaded from the main thread and executed inside of the thread pool or for some type of animations on the GPU. We also plan on physics aspects that we'd like to see appearing, and potentially AI and 3D positional audio. And the big thing, because here we basically have an engine, it has an API, but if we want to get serious about that, what we will need is also tooling. So we're looking at scene editor and also tool chains to be able to do asset conditioning so that you can have assets coming from your artist and then you actually pre-process them so that actually more performant ones that's consumed by the actual renderer later on. Okay, sorry for rushing a bit through that, but again, that's a condensed version of the condensed version of 3 days. I hope that gave you a good tour of what we have in there and what we're packing and what we're planning. And now if we still have time for questions and you have any questions, shoot.
Hey, so the entity has a components property, which is a list of components.
Yes.
Did you consider like having a transform component and a input component and things like that? I mean, instead of just putting them all into one array?
Ah, you mean like having several properties for the different types of?
Yeah.
The problem with that is that we want the entities and components that are part of the core, right? Because that's part of the core of our engine, right? And we want that core to be independent of the domain. So if we start to have an entity which is in the core, a property which is named input component, which would take only input component, then we have a dependency from the core toward the input and the input aspects and the input aspect depending on the core. So that's probably not something you would want.
Okay.
That's the main reason why you... Any other question?
Okay, so let's have a huge round of applause for Kevin.